So I was saying, I'm Rebecca Butensky. I'm the chair of the Department of Biostatistics at the NYU School of Global Public Health. And I'm joined tonight by our director of admissions, Dr. Zach Maggio. And he'll be talking at the end of our session, and he's the best person to answer many of your detailed questions. And then also we have some of our faculty from Biostatistics here, so I'll let them introduce themselves also. So I'm just gonna go around my screen, and I see Violet Xu. Do you wanna introduce yourself, please?
Hello, everyone. Nice to see you here. I'm Violet Xu. I'm a clinical assistant professor in Biostats.
Great. And Melody?
Hi, everyone. I'm Melody Goodman. I'm associate professor in the department.
Great. And Yang? Oh, you're muted.
All right. Sorry. Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Yang Feng. I'm the associate professor of biostatistics in the department. Yeah, good to see you, everyone.
Great. And Yang actually comes to us tonight from Shanghai, where he is teaching some of our students who are based in Shanghai this semester. So he's there for about 6 weeks. Is that right?
Yes.
Six, something like that. Yeah. Six or 7 weeks. Yeah. Okay. And hi.
Hi, everyone. I'm Hai Xu. I'm assistant professor of biostats.
Great, wonderful. Okay, so, and welcome to all of you. And I hope that we get to know you over the course of this year as you contemplate your graduate career and make your decisions about where to apply. And hopefully that includes NYU School of Global Public Health. So what I wanna do is actually begin by giving you an overview of the department and our programs. And then I will let you all ask, or then I guess, then we'll turn to Zach Maggio from admissions, and he'll tell you about the admissions process. And then we'll just open it up to your questions. And of course, our faculty will also speak, tell you more about their research and anything else that they want to add. The way that I'm going to do this is I'm going to tell the story through our website. So let me share my screen. And where I'm taking you is, let me just expand this a little bit. So I'm taking you to the website of the School of Global Public Health at NYU. So simple URL to remember, publichealth.nyu.edu. Of course, you can find us in other ways as well. And if you go to About and go to Departments and go to Biostatistics, you will find yourselves at the Biostatistics portion of the school's website. And like I said, I think this is a nice organized way to tell you about us and also to familiarize you with our website so that you can visit it many times as you want to learn more about the department and learn more about our programs. So here on our front page, you can read about the department. You can see that what do we do? Well, we strive, as it says here, strive for excellence in maybe three areas, maybe more. So first, innovative and groundbreaking methodological research that is relevant to public health. So we develop methods. We're statisticians, or statistical epidemiologists, or quantitative researchers. And so we're very interested in methods. And we want our methods to be relevant to public health problems. And we're completely guided by real public health problems. We're not just doing theory, though we like theory. We're doing theory that is motivated by needs of real problems, whether it's serious disparities in COVID-19 or any other kinds of real problems that arise from real data. We're also involved in collaborative research in public health issues. And so what I mean by that is that we all collaborate with investigators from other fields. So we're very multidisciplinary, and so we don't just work by ourselves with our computer. We work with scientists, we work with people in public health from other areas of public health. We work with physicians, we work with dentists, we work with all kinds of people from all kinds of, representing all kinds of different areas of expertise. And we contribute our expertise, and together that's a collaboration. And it's great fun, and it also leads to great results. And so that's what's really exciting and important about it. And then thirdly, we are, of course, very, very committed to the best education and training of students. And so we do that now at the master's level. And as you all know, we have both an MPH program in biostatistics and an MS program in biostatistics. And we also now do it at the PhD level. So we now have a concentration in biostatistics for the general PhD in public health that our school gives. And in addition to giving our students really excellent education and training to make them best prepared for jobs when they graduate or future graduate school, we're also very, very committed to and passionate about improving diversity in the fields of biostatistics and quantitative public health, and of course, in general. And so I'll tell you more about some of the efforts that we have in that area as well. So that's who we are in a nutshell. And if you scroll down on this page, I strongly encourage you to learn about us through different means. So here, first of all, you can watch a video introduction to our department. This was from an event that we held in July, where we really wanted to let the world know, or the world of potential students know, what do we do? What do biostatisticians do? And especially, what do we do in the time of COVID-19? And so here we talked a lot about, you can watch this video, and it's condensed from the full version. So it's condensed down to 20 minutes. You can also watch the full version, which is about an hour and a half. You can learn about what our faculty what kinds of COVID-19 research we were involved in, as well as other kinds of research. Of course, we do many things in addition to COVID-19. So this is yet another introduction to our department. Here in this middle space, you can read a really detailed departmental annual report that we put together from last year. And it's really very informative about the activities that we undertake as a department. And not just faculty, of course, but what the students do. And you can learn all about the kinds of activities that are available to students. So I encourage you to read our annual report. And then over here on the right, we have this fancy Twitter poster, because we're going to be putting it on a Twitter event, where we are telling the world about our really exciting new summer program. It's called Pipelines into Quantitative Aging Research. And so it's a pipeline program for undergraduates and potentially for recent graduates who are from underrepresented backgrounds and are interested in biostatistics and other areas of quantitative public health. And the program has a focus on aging research. So if you're interested in Alzheimer's disease, or the brain, studying the brain or other aspects of aging, this program brings it all together. So anyway, we're very proud of that, and we highlight that here on our front page. You can read down, we have a whole bunch of news items that we've listed here. I'm not going to go through them, but I strongly encourage you to read our news, see what we're about, see what we do. Here you see this nice picture in this beautiful classroom of our students who are in Shanghai, the NYU campus in Shanghai. And then you can click on this upcoming events, and you can read about upcoming events. And for example, tomorrow we have a seminar where we have a speaker, Dr. Loni Tabb from Drexel School of Public Health. And you can read about what she'll be talking about. Of course, everything is on Zoom these days, but in normal times, we sit in a room together. We have a nice seminar, and it's we get a chance to meet experts from other schools often. And then the second item that's listed here is an information session from Dr. Melody Goodman, whom you met earlier, from her lab, which is called the Measurement, Learning, and Evaluation Lab. So she's holding an information session for people, for students who are interested in potentially working with her and her large research group as part of her lab. And we have other lab events planned as well. So these are just two events, but we try to keep this up to date, and we have many events going on. You can read quotes from previous students. I'll let you do that on your own. Okay, second page, message from the chair. I'll leave this to you to read on your own. Third page, where we have our faculty and staff. So you can see we have 7 faculty members, and I know that I probably can't fit them all on the screen for you, but please go there yourself and you'll see there are 7 of us. I think there are 5 of us on tonight whom you've met, and then 2 additional faculty, Dr. Rumi Chunara and Dr. Stephanie Cook. And so you can learn more about them. You can click on their names and just and learn more about their background and their publications and what they do. And I strongly encourage you to do that. So one thing I can say is that there are 7 of us, but we're much bigger than 7 faculty members. And that's because our research areas are very broad. And oftentimes students want to work, you know, with maybe, or to be advised by more than one of us. And that together, you know, that's a synergy that creates even broader areas of opportunity. So we're really excited that we represent many areas of research, health disparities, machine learning, deep learning, clinical trials, missing data, biased sampling, many, many different areas. So I'm not even scratching the surface. So I encourage you to go visit. And then we have 2 wonderful staff members. Neither of them is here with us tonight, but they are very involved in supporting all of our work, in helping with everything that we do, and communicating with students. So hopefully you will get to know them as you go through the process of applying to our programs, hopefully. And then down here at the bottom, we have more information on our faculty labs. So you heard about Dr. Melody Goodman's lab because that's an upcoming event where she's holding an information session. Dr. Stephanie Cook also has planned an information session for her attachment and health disparities research lab. It's not yet on our website, but that is planned. We have a biostatistics consulting lab, and we had a session last week where we had about 5 different investigators who need statistical help and statistical consultations. They joined us, and they each took about 15 minutes to present the problems that they're working on. In many different areas of medicine, in the case of last week's investigators, it's not always coming from medicine. Sometimes we have public health investigators. And then we had students listening, and then the students had the opportunity to rank their choices and to select projects that they wanted to work on. And we're in the process of sorting that all out. But at the end of the day, we're going to have something like 9 different projects with between probably 2 to 3 students working on each project. So it's really an active group. And I advise the group, and I meet with them regularly and help whenever anybody needs help in how they're going to proceed with a problem, and we all talk it through together. So that's another lab opportunity. And I'll encourage you, again, to read through all of these labs that our faculty have organized that are open to students such as yourselves. Okay, I think I'm gonna turn actually to our faculty who are with us tonight and ask if any of you wanna add anything while I'm focused on our faculty page here, or the labs or the research aspect. Okay, all right, so a lot of information's here, and again, you should read, the students who are here should, you know, of course, read through this material, and then also feel free to follow up with any of us. So if, for example, you have a question for Stephanie Cook about what she does, please feel free to email her and ask her about what she does, or ask her any question that you might have. And that, of course, goes for any of us. Okay. Seminars and events. So I mentioned this previously. We have a lot going on, and I'm not going to go through all of these events, of course, but I do want to just highlight the three kinds of events that we have on a regular basis. So the first is a seminar series, and those we hold approximately monthly. And as you saw, we have one tomorrow. That was Dr. Loni Tabb from Drexel. And usually, those are usually faculty speakers who are presenting their research. This year in particular, we've decided to focus on the theme of anti-racism and racism in biostatistics, and how, as biostatisticians, we can address that and deal with it and improve anything that needs to be improved. And so that will be a theme of our seminars throughout the year. Not entirely, we will certainly have other seminars that may not have anything to do with that theme, but that is an important theme to us. And that is something that's going to organize our sessions coming up. The second type of event is the journal club. And so that is, of course, these are all optional, I should say. Nobody is required to attend any of these. So the journal club is a meeting, again, about once a month, and for each meeting, a different student volunteers to be the leader. And as the leader, that student selects one or two articles in any area at all that they're interested in, that they then send to the group or send to our whole department. Anybody who's interested reads the articles and shows up to the journal club. And then the student leader will lead the discussion. They'll start off by telling us why they selected that article. So oftentimes it's because they themselves wanted to learn something. So they wanted to learn more about random effects models, let's say, or latent class models or something, you name it. Or maybe they're working with Dr. Goodman and they want to learn more about survey sampling. So she suggested an article to them, and so they bring that article to the journal club. So people make good use of this journal club to learn something on a deeper level that they want to learn. And then we all benefit from that. They lead the discussion and they'll ask questions and everybody participates. And everybody gets something out of it, and people attend, of course, come with different backgrounds and therefore understand, take away understanding at different levels, but it's still worthwhile for everybody. And then the last set of events that we hold are professional development events. And these are programs or events at which we try to enhance your development as a professional. So we will talk about interviewing for jobs. We'll talk about where to apply for jobs, what kinds of jobs you should consider. We may have somebody from different, we may have people from different industries coming and talking about, their workplace and what does it mean to be a master's level biostatistician in their type of work. We also include some technical development sessions where we might do a presentation on how to write an R markdown file or how to do something technical in computing that you may not learn in your classes, but you may really want to know because it would be very helpful to you. So those are also types of sessions that fall within this series. So I encourage you to take a look through these to see what we've done in the past. So I'm going quickly. Here we have our journal club. You can look through from past, so from what we did this like last week as well as last year, and then going down to professional development, you can see we recently had a session on summer internships, how to find a summer internship. We've had sessions in the past on PhD programs, because we have some of our master students are interested in pursuing a PhD. Here is one of the technical kinds of sessions that we had, where we had Chuck Huber from Stata Corporation came and gave two full sessions on how to implement technical analyses using the software, the statistical software package Stata. So that was really an incredible offering that we were able to give to our students. Last year, and I strongly encourage you to visit this one. So last year we had a panel discussion on careers in biostatistics and data science. We had six professionals who were master's level statisticians, biostatisticians, working in a whole range of different fields. And they came and they spoke about their preparation for their job and advice that they had for students. And you can watch the full video here if you're interested. So I encourage you to look here, but this is just to give you a flavor of what you can expect as a student in our department. We're always open to suggestions. So if there is a student who has an idea for a professional development series that we haven't thought of, we are more than happy to plan around that. Okay, so here is a page on our consulting lab. I already told you about this, so I won't spend any more time on this. Now I want to take you to our current student page. So I didn't tell you very much about our current students, so let me do that. Take a minute and do that. So we currently have 92 master's students. About two-thirds of them are in our MS program and one-third in our MPH program. As you all know, it's a two-year program. In addition to our two master's programs, we also have a PhD program. I'm interested to know if anyone here tonight is interested in the PhD program, who would be applying to the PhD program this year. Maybe tell me in the chat if you don't want to say it. Okay, I'm not seeing.
Yes, I'm interested in the PhD program, Prof.
I'm sorry, I didn't say that again.
Yes, I am interested in the PhD program this year.
Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you for telling me. So I will say a little bit more about it than I would have otherwise. And of course, many of you master's students may very well be interested in the PhD program in 3 years, you know, or 2 years from now, or longer. So in addition to our 92 master's students, we are very excited that this is our first year with a PhD concentration in biostatistics, and we have two PhD students in biostatistics. And I will direct you back to our landing page where you can read about their backgrounds if you're interested. So here they are listed here. You can click on this link and you can read about their backgrounds. So interestingly, and I won't dwell too much on this, Jessica is coming from an MS degree in biostatistics, Whereas Zoe is coming straight from undergraduate. And I'm telling you that just to make sure that you understand that that we don't require students to have a master's degree in order to apply to or attend our PhD program. Either way works. And this is just a perfect example of one PhD student coming straight from undergrad and one coming from an MS followed by a year working. Okay, so let me go back. So current students. Okay, so now back to our master's students. One question that we often get from potential students is, well, where do your graduates go? What do they do? And so here we put together a list. It's not an exhaustive list of where our graduates are working. And you can scroll down here, you can look, you can see that there's a range of different kinds of places where they're working. So some of them are at academic medical centers, Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center in Boston, it's a Harvard hospital. Some of them are at NYU School of Medicine. Here's a student who's a dental student. Here is a student who is a biostatistician at the Hospital for Special Surgery in New York. We have students at companies, a pharmaceutical company here. So it's a whole range of possibilities. And again, this is a small subset, but really, we feel that we prepare our students very, very well to go out into many different possible work settings. So let me go back. Okay, and then here are just some resources that are available to students. You can browse through this. There's great computing resources at NYU, and I just want to highlight that. The library through the data services offers many, many short courses. They're free, they're not for credit, but they're extremely useful in learning different software packages and learning many, many different skills. And so that's a really great opportunity. You can look through their offerings. And many, many, many other great offerings. We also on this page list general opportunities for students, not just in our department. So we have various conferences that are coming up make students aware of different opportunities that are available to them. And then whenever we come across interesting articles or podcasts, we try to post them as well. So this is just a nice resource page. And then finally here, we have this very nice long list of job opportunities. So again, we try to keep this up to date. And I think as of today, it's pretty much up to date. Of course, these things always turn over. But what's nice about this list is that it's really long. There are many, many opportunities. And even now in this time of this global pandemic, there are still many, many opportunities for biostatisticians. And so you should all feel really good about getting a master's degree or a PhD, of course, as well in biostatistics. There are many places where you will be highly sought as a very valuable employee. And then finally, down at the bottom of the page, we're still working on the organization of this page, but we've listed our student theses. So one requirement of our program is a thesis, a master's thesis. All master's students, both MPH and MS students, write a thesis in their second year. And I encourage you to browse through these pages. So here we have class of 2020, this tab is class of 2019, just to see the kinds of projects that our students have worked on. So here we have some slides, a few posters, and then if you go to 2019, that year they all made posters. So again, I strongly encourage you to look through these. These are extremely valuable experiences for the students. They learn a great deal and it's a really great accomplishment. Not to mention, it's a really great product to put on your resume as you look for a job following your degree. Okay, let's see, go to prospective students. So here's just a page where we've gathered links to our graduate programs. Of course, you can find them in other places on our school's website. So we have both master's programs, we have our PhD, we have a place where you can see how the two programs compare to each other. If you're wondering, well, how do I know if I want the MPH or the MS, you can look here. Okay, and then down at the bottom here, again, I encourage you, these are videos of past events. I mentioned, I think, all of them. This first one is that longer event we had in July. This is the full recording. Roles of biostatistics and data science in the age of COVID-19. You can hear what we have to say about that and how we've played a role there, as well as, you know, just in general, what kinds of research our faculty work on. Here's the panel that I mentioned. And this down here is an information session actually from almost 2 years ago. So it's a little dated and maybe you don't want to go to this one because you're here tonight, but these first two certainly would be useful. Okay, and then down at the bottom, we have a few other pages that contain other areas that we are, you know, working on steadily and regularly and very interested in. I mentioned previously our whole focus on anti-racism, diversity, equity, and inclusion. So here we've listed news, we've listed news and resources, where we've listed many different activities that our faculty have undertaken and have led, such as courses over the summer, conferences, different kinds of trainings, many, many different initiatives that we've undertaken. So again, it's something that we care about very, very much and we all work on. And then here you can look at relevant faculty publications and other resources and podcasts. So this is a page in development and we're continually adding to this and enhancing these resources. Here we have a COVID-19 research page. So as statisticians and epidemiologists and public health professionals, this is something that we're very much involved in. And here's a page just to show you the kinds of work, again, that our faculty and students have engaged in related to COVID-19. So we have several publications from all of us. We also very quickly put together several summer courses. Most of them were related to COVID-19. So for example, I taught this 2504 course, an introduction to clinical trials course using COVID-19 as a case study. So we talked about clinical trials in general, but almost every example that we used or protocol that we looked at or sample size calculation that we did was related to a COVID-19 trial. And likewise for many of these other courses. So again, this is to illustrate that we're very engaged in the world from a professional point of view, and we're very interested in making important contributions and enhancing our students' experiences here. Okay, and lastly, we have the website for our pipelines program, our summer program. I'm not going to say too much about this tonight, but if any of you know of anybody who might be interested, or if any of you are interested yourselves and you're qualified, you're eligible for the program, I would be happy to speak with you another time. So I think I have given you the very broad overview of the department. So let me stop sharing my screen. And again, before I turn to Zach, I'm just going to ask the faculty again if any of you have anything you want to add to anything that I've said.
Okay.
Okay. So again, I encourage you all to read about the faculty, read about their research, their labs, and you know, please feel free to reach out to them, to send them an email if you have questions, you know, anything like that. They will be more than happy to respond to any of your questions. Okay, so let me turn things over to Zach, again, the Director of Admissions. So please, Zach.
Thank you, Rebecca. I'm gonna share my screen here if that's okay. So I'm gonna walk people through a quick overview of how you can apply to these great programs in biostatistics. I'll talk a little bit about eligibility, the specific application requirements, the process, the deadlines, and we'll talk a little bit about financial aid as well. Everybody can see my screen, right? Can we just confirm that?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. Because you know, you don't want to get 5 minutes in.
Yes, I can.
See your screen. Yeah. So in order to apply for either the master's or the doctoral programs, all applicants have to have at least a bachelor's degree or the equivalent to a bachelor's degree in the United States. There are no specific prerequisite majors per se. In other words, we don't screen applications by a particular field of study. It's not required that you have a particular degree in a particular area in order to apply. There are no minimum GPAs. We don't screen applications by GPA. It's not as if you have a GPA that's, you know, below 3.0, which is sort of a commonly used benchmark in the US. It's not as if we don't review your application, and it doesn't mean you won't get admitted. We do admit people who have GPAs at the lower end of the scale, and because there's all kinds of reasons why applicants might have lower GPAs, and we understand those reasons. And so what we look at when we look at applications is the entire picture of the applicant's background and experiences, the kinds of opportunities they've had, and how they've taken advantage of the opportunities, what the essay says, what the letters say, and no one element of an application, such as the GPA, will cause an application to be accepted or rejected. Similarly, we don't have minimum work experience requirements. It's important to keep that in mind because some schools do. Some other schools and programs you're considering may have 2 year, 3 year, or even up to 5 year work experience requirements. NYU GPH doesn't have those kinds of requirements. We really do encourage applicants from a wide variety of academic and professional backgrounds to apply. We often get asked in the admissions office what your ideal candidate is. And I don't know that there is an ideal candidate, because I think a wide variety of kinds of people with different kinds of backgrounds and interests and skills can benefit from this kind of education and contribute to the program. There may be, you know, and I'll ask Rebecca and her colleagues to chime in if there are specific types of coursework or experience that they would like to see in their biostatistics applicants. But my view from the admissions office is, you know, we're looking for a diverse set of candidates, and that can encompass a wide range of backgrounds. In terms of how to apply, if you don't know what SOFIS is already, SOFIS stands for schools and that is the common application for schools and programs of public health. And so you can use the SOFIS application service to easily submit one application to multiple schools. So it makes it a lot easier if you're considering more than one school. Applying through SOFIS means that you're not submitting documents directly to NYU. You're not gonna mail us your transcript. All of that material goes to SOFIS, and I would refer you to their, they have their own application instructions for how to complete the SOFIS application. Just keep in mind that the letters and the transcripts are not going to come to us in the admissions office at NYU. If you are an international applicant, you do have to complete an evaluation, a credential evaluation by World Education Services, known as WES, which can also be connected directly to your SOFIS application from the organization WES and their instructions for how to do that in the SOFIS platform. We do require 3 letters of recommendation. This can all be done through the SOFIS platform. You enter the information in about your recommenders. The system contacts them and invites them to submit the recommendation. So, my advice, we get asked often about the mix between academic and professional, and I think that has a lot to do with whether you're in school now or whether you've been out of school for a long time. And so there is no one right answer that will be true for everybody. So, you know, you'll want to think about who can best speak in a supervisory way to your potential and your abilities to succeed in graduate school. So my only rule with recommenders is that it's no family, no friends, no clergy. It has to be people who have supervised either your academic or professional work. Importantly, the GRE is not required this year for either master's or doctoral admissions. So you know, if you're thinking about taking the GRE, maybe some schools are still requiring it. My understanding is most schools at this point are not requiring it, at least for this year. So hopefully if you were not looking forward to it, you don't have to take it. If you did take it and report your score in, it will appear in your application. I will leave it to Rebecca and her colleagues to say anything about what they'll do with the GRE score if they see it. I don't know, Rebecca, if you're planning on disregarding it entirely or if it will make a difference, but I'll leave that to you. If English is not your native language and you did not complete the equivalent of a US bachelor's degree at an institution where English is the primary language of instruction, you will be required to submit a TOEFL exam result. So we conduct rolling admissions at NYU GPH, meaning we make decisions as we receive applications, which means the earlier you apply, the earlier you get a decision. So the deadline for fall admission to the PhD is earlier. It's December 1st. If you're applying to the MPH or MS programs, it's February 1st. Typically, we try to return a decision within 2 to 3 weeks of an application becoming complete, meaning we have all of the required materials to consider it. Typically, PhD applicants are notified in late February after an interview process. Selected candidates will be invited to interview. Important to make sure that you have all of your required documents considered. We will not review incomplete applications. So even if your application is complete but missing one letter, it won't go to review until we get that third letter. So we need all materials in. I know financial aid is a big concern for everyone. Financing graduate education is obviously an important concern, and understandably. So we do have program scholarships available. They're merit-based, they're competitive. We automatically consider you when you apply. There's no separate form. You don't have to do anything other than ask to be considered for it. There actually is a question in the application asking, do you want to be considered for aid? If you answer no to that question, you won't be considered. So if you do want to be considered for scholarships, I encourage you to answer yes to that question. We do consider international students for these scholarships in the same way that we consider domestic students. And for scholarships, you don't have to file the FAFSA, which is the application for federal student aid. Now, the scholarships range anywhere from $5,000 to $20,000 a year. So even the biggest scholarships don't cover the full cost of the education. Many of our students depend on other forms of aid. Most prominently, if you're a US citizen or permanent resident, you can apply for federal aid, which are really subsidized and unsubsidized student loans, and or federal work study, which allows you to get some aid money to work on campus. For those forms of aid, the FAFSA is required. We also have some other scholarship programs like the Coverdell Fellows Program, which is for returned Peace Corps volunteers exclusively. And if you are a US veteran or veteran of the US Armed Forces, we do participate in the Yellow Ribbon Matching Program. This slide predominantly refers to master's programs. The funding situation for doctoral candidates is very different. Doctoral fellows at GPH are funded, fully funded for 5 years, including full tuition remission, health insurance, and an annual stipend guaranteed for the 5 years as long as the student continues to make satisfactory academic progress through the program. If you're thinking about ways of financing your education, I encourage you to visit the Association of Schools and Programs of Public Health site, ASPPH Financing Your Degree. It's a database of scholarship and financial aid opportunities, tips and tricks on how to obtain scholarships. And it's nice because it's an up-to-date searchable database of scholarship opportunities. So if you're looking for external funding, it can be really useful. The URL is there, or you could just Google ASPPH Financing Your Degree. And so that's pretty much it. I didn't want to get too in-depth. I'm happy to do one-on-one sessions with people. We are happy to meet with you personally. We do weekly information sessions online. We can put you in touch with current students. We can put you in touch with faculty. We can even arrange for you to virtually sit in on some of the virtual coursework that's happening now. Our email address is gph.admissions@nyu.edu. If you visit the admissions section of our website, you can sign yourself up using a calendar there for a one-on-one admissions advising appointment. So that's what I have for you. I'm happy to take any questions anybody might have about admissions.
So I'll jump in and just add that both for master's applications and PhD applications, your personal statement is very, very important. We really look to that to learn about you and to learn why you want this degree in biostatistics that you're applying for. So we really want to see a compelling case that you're making, that, you know, why you want to come to school to get a master's in or a PhD in biostatistics. So that is very, very important. So that's just as important as, the courses that you've taken and your letters of recommendation. You know, they're all together, they make the whole package. So make sure you put a lot of effort into that. Let's see, questions in the chat. Is there a link to the classes offered in their syllabi? Yes, there is. Can I ask Violet, do you know where that is?
I'm looking for.
Okay, great. Okay, so Violet will put that in the chat. I see. So it looks like Yang beat her to it. Thank you. Okay, so let's see, what else? General advice for master's applicants. Like I said, that personal statement is very important. I don't know, do any of the other faculty here, who many of you have read many applications, do you have any other advice? Melody?
So it seems like Rebecca, I invited this issue about the GRE. I think it could use a little bit of departmental clarification because departments are handling it kind of differently. So if you could say something about how you'll view GRE scores if people do submit them this year.
Okay. First I want to give Melody an opportunity. So I think, were you about to give general advice?
I was just going to say, try to get strong letters of recommendation. So you want letters of recommendation for people who can really talk about you as a person, so they know you, not just some faculty member who's going to say you were one out of however many students in their class and you got this grade. So you want people that can sort of speak to you a little bit more personally as well. So you want really strong letters of recommendation.
Yeah, and I will second that. I won't reveal any names, but I will never forget a letter of recommendation that I read from a very, very, very big name statistician who essentially wrote one sentence in his letter saying, you know, so-and-so received an A in my class. Okay, that doesn't tell me anything more than the transcript. And that's not nearly as useful as a much less well-known faculty member writing a full page explaining how the student, you know, contributed to the research. So it's very, very important. So regarding GREs, so I guess what I would say is, in some sense, it's no different from how we've looked at GREs any time. So we've never had a threshold for GREs. GREs are, you know, one little input into the whole picture. And so I to be honest, our faculty has not discussed this as a faculty. So I'm speaking for myself and need to speak to the whole faculty, but I don't know that we would, we certainly would never hold it against anybody not to present us with a GRE. So you shouldn't worry for a second if you haven't taken the GRE, or if you have and you don't want to send it in because you don't have to. We won't think twice. You won't be penalized in any way at all. So I'll leave it at that. I don't know. Does anybody want to chime in with anything else about that? Okay. All right, so another question, does NYU plan to be virtual hybrid in fall 2021? Well, that is a great question. I don't think anybody knows the answer to that. My guess would be it'll be less virtual than it is now. And remember, you may or may not know, you probably do know, NYU is having some in-person classes this semester. Many of them are hybrid, meaning some in-person, some online, some are entirely online, but there are some courses that do have an in-person, component. So I guess if I were a betting person, I would bet that whatever we are now, we'll have more of it in a year, but who knows? That's the best I can do with that one. Okay, why should a student be penalized if a recommending faculty is being vindictive? Oh, this is not about a faculty member being vindictive about a lukewarm recommendation. This is about what I'm speaking about. Let me just clarify. So thank you for the question. What I'm speaking about is a faculty member who really doesn't know the student at all, and the student asking the faculty member for a recommendation because that faculty member has a really, really big name, and they think having a big name writing a letter will carry some weight. And my point is just, it only carries weight if that person knows you. And the student obviously knows if the faculty member knows them. So I'm not at all thinking about a faculty letter being vindictive or callous. Okay, so, right, so perhaps, and yeah. So basically what I'm saying is use your good judgment and ask for a letter from somebody who knows you, and you know, faculty write fantastic letters when they know the student. Okay, I don't have much research experience. Is research experience required for the PhD program application? So anybody else want to take that one?
Actually, our program is very competitive. Last year, we got a long list of applicants. And so those people who stand out had rich research experience.
Yeah, I mean, it's important to know that you want to do research. So, if you have, and to know that you want to do research, you probably need to have done something. But I can imagine that, you know, maybe you don't have extensive research experience, but you know enough because you've been exposed, to enough, to know what it is about and to know that that's what you want. And you've taken enough courses to know that this is the subject area that you want to pursue. So it's certainly not required to have extensive research experience, but like I guess the guiding principle is you should know enough about research to know that you want a PhD, because a PhD is a research degree.
Right. I want to add a little bit on that. So
okay,
so I want to remind everyone that sometimes you are doing some research, maybe in your course projects, so that would also count. So that the overall idea is that you want to show us like you are interested and capable of carrying out interesting research, right? So you have different ways to show that. Yeah, you can show that you have a solid training in the techniques required to do the research, and you can also show that okay, I've done this very interesting problem, and maybe it's just a course project, but you can also share like what's your finding and what is your view on that, right? So I think all of those helps.
Yeah, great, thank you. Yeah, that's, and just to follow up on that, you know, definitely there are courses that you may have taken that required you, to, let's say, do a simulation study comparing different methods. I mean, so that's research, and you could write about that, or you know, maybe that's what your experience consists of. So there are many ways of having that kind of experience. So what else do people want to know? Okay. Okay, any advice on how I can gain research experience as a post-bac student? So so I guess I'm not quite clear what you're asking. Are you saying, this is to Stephanie who asked the question, that you want to, you're planning to enter a post-bac program? And then, and you want to know how to gain research experience while you're enrolled in a post-bac program? Or do you just mean, how can you gain experience if you already have your bachelor's degree?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Hi.
Yeah, I'm asking, I'm currently a student at SUNY Oswego. I'm pursuing my Master of Science in Biomedical and Health Informatics. I hope to gain my degree in December, but I don't have much research experience in the program. I'm completing a thesis, but I'm unsure if that one course is enough experience for me to apply to the program.
To the PhD program, do you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, maybe it would be best for you and I, or you and one of our faculty members, to sort of speak separately on your particular, you know, your so we could look at your background, the courses you've taken, and the type of thesis that you're writing, so we can give you a better and more personalized answer to that. So I think, why don't you follow up with one of us, and we can help, we can discuss that with you.
Okay, will do. Thank you.
Okay, good. Thank you. Okay, speak about the differences of the goals of the students who are in the MPH versus the MS program. So I am going to turn to Dr. Goodman for that.
So I guess I would say our MPH is for students that are really interested in public health generally, because you take core courses in all of the core public health disciplines, and then you do your concentration in biostat. And our MS program is more sort of research focused, and primarily you take courses in epidemiology and biostatistics. Those what I think would be the main differences. So MPH students get more exposure to other disciplines in public health outside of epidemiology and biostatistics.
Yes, and like I said earlier, there is a comparison table that we have on the website that sort of makes direct comparisons between the requirements that might be helpful for you to take a look at. Maybe somebody can put the link to that in the chat. Great. Anything else from anybody? Okay. Well, I know there are competing events going on tonight, and people may like to get off the Zoom and go to the competing events, such as I learned earlier today, the Yankees are playing the Cleveland Indians in baseball, and maybe there's something else going on also. Anyway, that was just a joke. So anyway, thank you all for joining us, and please follow up, and we are more than happy to answer your questions. It can be on a Zoom call, it can be on a phone call, it can be in an email, whatever you like. And you know, that goes for any of us, Zach in admissions, or any of the faculty here, or our two additional faculty members who aren't here tonight. So again, thank you all, and I really hope to see your names many times over as the year unfolds. So good luck with everything. Take care. Bye-bye, everyone.